Good afternoon to everybody. I am Andrea Genazzani, and it's our pleasure for all the members of the International Society of Gynecological Endocrinology to offer this pre-congress course. The decision to make the pre-congress course is also to cover the time between the expected congress, which was postponed from March to December in Firenze. And this series of webinar start with a very important topic, which is insulin resistance. And we have asked.
Because, sir.
Yes, and Professor Andrei Milevich will speak about that one. And we think that this is a key factor who strongly dominate the human life. Then, Professor Milevich, can you start with your presentation on environment factor responsible for insulin resistance in women?
Yes, thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I have a really pleasure and honor to join a webinar organized by the International Gynecological Endocrinology Society. I would like to discuss today with you the topic of environmental factors responsible for insulin resistance in women. I have no financial. So according to the definition of insulin resistance, normally insulin knocking to the door of the muscle hear the knock, open up and lets glucose in. In cases of insulin resistance, the muscle cannot hear the knocking of the insulin because they are resistant, and pancreas makes more insulin, which increase insulin levels in blood, and we observe hyperinsulinemia, but the serum glucose in insulin resistant case is ranging normal. Is a pre-diabetic stage. A really important role in etiology of insulin resistance play insulin receptor. We can recognize a pre-receptor insulin resistance, a receptor insulin resistance, as well as post-receptor insulin resistance. Pre-receptor resistance we can recognize in case with insulin mutation syndrome, in the case with elevated titer of insulin antibody, elevated level of hormones which presented activity against insulin like cortisol, glucagon, or thyroid hormone. And receptor insulin resistance we can recognize in case when we observe decreased number of insulin receptor or decreased affinity of this receptor. Post-receptor insulin resistance we can expect it in case of disturbances with glucose transporter to the cell, as well as in cases of increased lipolysis. So three organs play really important role in etiology of insulin resistance. The first one is a fatty tissue. Of course, you know that fatty tissue is a very active endocrine organ which produces several hormones, protein and adipokine, like leptin, adiponectin, TNF-alpha, or retinol binding protein, which could play crucial role in sensitivity for insulin as well as insulin resistance. Also, the liver play a really important role because the liver is responsible for glucose endogenous production, I mean gluconeogenesis and glucolysis. And basic symptom of hepatic insulin resistance is impaired suppression of gluconeogenesis and glucolysis into insulin, the effect of which is hyperglycemia. Very important role play glucagon, as they affected endogenous production of glucose contrapositively to insulin, and lack of its inhibition causes insulin resistance. An important feature of hepatic fatty degradation is the accumulation of triglyceride in hepatocyte, what we observe in non-alcoholic fatty liver, for example. So a really important role plays a third organ, I mean muscle. The muscles are insulin main effector responsible for insulin-dependent glucose trap. Insulin promotes glucose tetrahydrolysis in the form of glycogen. And in insulin resistant status, impairment of insulin-stimulated translocation of GLUT4 to myocyte cellular membrane is a primary disorder. The effect is a decrease of glucose transported to the cell central area, as well as the reduction of glucagon synthesis and glucose oxidation. So Dr. Jean Vaque was the first guy who said that not fatty tissue, total fatty tissue amount is important, but fatty tissue distribution. And for that reason, so we can recognize three phenotypes of obesity: classic obesity with metabolic disorders, with accumulation of the fat in intraperitoneal area, like you can see on the graph, with thin subcutaneous fat, as well as also pathological accumulation fat in the muscle and in the liver. The same pathology, but not so strong, we observe in the other phenotype of obesity, I mean obesity with metabolic disorders, but with normal weight. It's a slim young people. It's a good example of this phenotype of obesity is a lean PCOS patient. In that woman, we observe also pathological accumulation of the fat, not in the fatty tissue, but in the intraperitoneal area, in the muscle, as well in the liver. For that reason, so we very often in a lean PCOS patient, we can expect it a non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. In contrast, it exists also healthy obesity phenotype, which presented high deposit of subcutaneous fat in comparison to peritoneal. It's a typical obesity for reproductive age of women. How we can estimate it, insulin resistance? So it's a several marker like HOMA, Firi, Matsuda, Quickie. But for everyday praxis, I propose you to if you expect it in your patient insulin resistance, please do oral glucose tolerance test. If your fasting insulin levels is over 35 international unit per ml, 2 hours after administration of 75 gram of glucose, so you can expect it insulin resistance in that case. So let's go to the environmental factor. What is the definition? According to the International Epidemiological Association, environmental, as all that which is external to human host, can be divided into physical, biological, social, culture, etc., any or all of which can influence healthy state of population. So the most popular environmental factor are endocrine disrupting chemicals. According to the definition, an endocrine disrupting chemicals is an exogenous chemical or mixture of chemicals that can interfere with any aspect of hormonal action. The potential for the deleterious effect of ADC must be considered relative to the regulation of hormone synthesis, secretion, and action. So it's a really serious problem because if you have a look, I saw in 2011, 96% of pregnant women was tested positively for bisphenol A, which is a crucial endocrine disruptor with the chemical structure close to diethylstilbestrol. So the worst news is that the children from this pregnant mother, newborn children, presented 3 times higher concentration of endocrine disruptor in comparison to the mother. The mother detoxicated during the pregnancy. It's a horrible news, but it's true. Anyway, so with breastfeeding, the mother also gives the endocrine disruptor to her child, because if you look for this data, they show that 40 times higher concentration of endocrine disruptors was found in breastfeeding mother in the United States in comparison to European one. Each year come over 2,000 new chemicals from which several of them presented endocrine activity. The also very bad news is that the endocrine disruptors decrease IQ in children. 3 to 5 points. It's relatively big amount. So how endocrine disruptors activated hormone action? One mechanism is ADC can influence hormone metabolism in tissue-specific manner, and the metabolites may directly interfere with hormone action only in this tissue where they are generated. Second possibility, a hypothesis, is the endocrine disruptor and the metabolites may also interact with the hormone receptor in tissue-specific manner and exert direct agonist or antagonist action. Either because some tissue exhibit greater receptor density or because different receptor isoforms are expressed in different tissue. So the recent evidence suggests the third possibility that some endocrine disruptors may cause epigenetic changes, which is in turn may lead to transgenerational effect of ADC on numerous organ synthesis. Epigenetic changes are discovered as heritable change in a gene expression that are out to change in the cell. So bisphenol A is one of the common plasticizer, and it was first synthesized in 1891 and discovered to be estrogenic in 1936. The xenoestrogen bisphenol A is especially prevalent as a component used in rigid plastic products such as compact disc, dental material, cosmetics, food and beverage container, food and formula can link to glossy paper resin. In case of food container, when they are hit or scratched, the bisphenol A can slip out into the food and then be ingested. So this puzzle show you how bisphenol A can stimulate obesity and insulin resistance and provoke dyslipidemia, fatty liver disease, and also by that way, so increased risk for diabetes type 2 and cardiovascular disease, and also disturb steroidogenesis in the ovary as well and in testes. And in the last decade, we observed dramatically decreased quality of sperm in men because of the horrible influence of bisphenol A. So it's a really serious problem. Also, according to the influence of bisphenol A on the ovary, so it can be suggested that bisphenol A may contribute to the pathogenesis of PCOS because elevated bisphenol A levels were reported in women with anovulatory dysfunction compared with regularly ovulating women. Also, BPA alter androgen metabolism in the liver and acting as a potent sex binding globulin binder displays androgen resulting and in increased level of serum androgen. That's our data, which shows that bisphenol A is strongly correlated with HOMA index, insulin resistance, as well with free androgen index in women with PCOS. And second environmental factor, which is play a really important role in the etiology of insulin resistance, is advanced glycated end products. So endogenously, they increase in our body with aging, hyperglycemia, as well with increased oxidant stress. But exogenously, we can stimulate the concentration of AGS levels in our body during the not healthy, because of not healthy food, thermally processed foods that are rich for protein and reducing sugar. It's a really serious problem because if you have a look for this graph, so this advanced glycated end products disturb ovarian steroidogenesis, disturb fertility, disturb adipose tissue function and stimulate inflammation, which is very important in sorry, in several diseases. What is good news that which is brilliantly presented in that graph published by our colleagues, Dr. Diamante Kandarakis, that the diet with low advanced glycated end products, eucaloric, after a few months, so decrease their levels of testosterone, testosterone, HOMA index, oxidative stress, as well as BMI. So it's a new proposal for treatment strategy for PCOS patients. So the third environmental factor is vitamin D. As you can see on that map, in the world, so it's, we have actually as a world vitamin D deficiency epidemic. You can see in each country, so the number of vitamin D deficient cases is extremely high. The problem is important because it's the vitamin D is not healthy in bone. But as you can see, so the pleiotropic action of vitamin D was shown and still is revealed. And vitamin D play important role in nephroprotection, glucose metabolism, endothelial and cardiovascular protection, regular of apoptosis, control muscular and neuronal function, control estradiol and testosterone level, control our immune system, several other stuff. For that reason, so the, we can expect that, vitamin D deficiency, several health problems. What is the common risk factor for vitamin D deficiency? Why so often we can expect it in our civilization? So because the risk factor is having dark skin, being elderly, being overweight or obese, not eat much fish or dairy, living far from equator where there is little sun year round, always using sunscreen when going out, and staying indoors. So that's a point and the explanation why the vitamin D deficiency is so frequent recognized in our population. So the clinical symptom of vitamin D deficiency is getting sick or infection very often, fatigue and tiredness, bone and back pain, depression, impaired wood healing, bone loss, hair loss, and muscle pain. So I would like to recommend you Polish recommendation, which has, however, so they are from 2013, but still actual. So when the serum levels of vitamin D is lower than 10, it's a really severe deficiency. If normally in children, when the vitamin D in serum is lower than 20 nanogram per ml, so we also in children or adolescents recognize vitamin D deficiency. In adult, as a level lower than 30 nanogram per ml, also suggested vitamin D deficiency. How to treat them? So this graph show you, it depends on are you newborn or infants or children or adults. So you, the dose is different. And we start with this dose for 1 to 3 months. And what is very important is of course, follow up. Every 1 to 3 months, we can estimate it vitamin D to have a look how successful is our treatment, because sometimes this the absorption is not enough, and so we can start to use the active form of vitamin D, not pre-hormone, but active hormone, and also to 24-hour urinary calcium excretion to creatinine index is very, very important. So, ladies and gentlemen, so remember that insulin resistance caused by endocrine disruptive chemicals, but advanced glycated end products, and by vitamin D deficiency. We can support, and I think that we discussed that point during the discussion. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Milevich. I will, before starting with the next speaker, I would like to invite all of you to send your question. You can see in the screen, you can, on the right side of the screen, you can see question and answer. You can write your question and we will use this question for the debate at the end of the presentation. And then it's my pleasure now to introduce you, Professor Alessandro Genazzani, who will develop another chapter of insulin resistance, who is the update on the integrative treatment for insulin resistance in polycystic ovary syndrome. Please, Alessandro.
Thank you very much, Professor Genazzani and friends. And here we are with my presentation. I have been spending a lot of time for several years going through the issues of being stressed, being lean, and it's a matter of time that I moved to another topic, which is the problem of having probably too much energy stored, and what is the relevant issue of those who are overweight or obese, the presence of insulin resistance. The facts are interesting, and is that the presence of a metabolic impairment, which is related to overweight or maybe to the predisposition to have diabetes in the family, starts just with the pregnancy. When you were just a fetus inside the uterus of your mother, if your mother was exposed to gestational diabetes or you have any kind of predisposition to diabetes, you have a sort of mark that might be developing after you are born. And this is more severe in young women, in girls, during adolescence, and maybe later during reproductive period, and later on in menopause. And menopause is the final act where we might have the problem and the predisposition to more severe cardiovascular disease. So when we talk about PCOD, we have here in this cartoon the complete set of the impairments related to the hormonal pattern, but the main topic is insulin, the high level of insulin that these patients have. PCOS, classically, are the unique kind of endocrine, gynecological endocrine disease with high level of insulin. And such high level of insulin are related to a sort of resistance to the whole set of tissues and organs of the body to the presence of insulin. And this is typical, yes, for overweight people or obese people, at least 75% of them, but at least 10 up to 20 normal weight patients with PCOS have the presence of such kind of insulin resistance. So this story tells immediately to us that probably the excess of body weight is not the only issue that we might have. Probably, if you are normal weight with insulin resistance, there is something wrong in the mechanics of your metabolism that are impairing the metabolism itself and the insulin resistance. Well, but when we talk about insulin and the excess of insulin, we do not have to think that insulin is a bad hormone. It's absolutely an important, relevant hormone, but in the normal levels, in the normal amounts. So as you can see here, insulin is talking with the reproductive axis through a specific relationship with GnRH. It stimulates GnRH, but it also stimulates at the ovarian level the activity of the granulosa cells. It interferes in the production of androgens going through a specific modulation of the LH activity on the granulosa cells. But check what is written in the upper part of the slide, that 65% of all PCOS have at a high percentage of rate the presence of diabetic familial. Someone, parent or just relatives, fathers, grandfathers, mothers, grandmothers, with diabetes or diabetes type 2, which is the trigger that gives us the idea that our patient in front of us with PCOS might be more vulnerable for a metabolic disease. So when we think about a little bit on how to face, obviously, such kind of situation, which is disclosed by the classic oral glucose tolerance test, well, the first thing that we have to say is that that patient needs to be on diet, needs to be a little bit doing some exercises. This is lifestyle rules. And Deneuf, Professor Deneuf, demonstrated clearly that this is the best treatment that we might have. But we know very well that we might use also compounds, and metformin is a very well-known very old but very effective compound. But on the other side, we have absolutely the chance and the possibility to use just integrative compounds. And the most known up to now are inositols and lipoic acids. Well, the very thing that we have to say is that metformin is rather good, is absolutely optimal for patients with insulin resistance. But as you can see in this quite old study, is 12 years old, that we made using metformin, is very effective in patients who are hyperinsulinemic. The items that the metformin is able to restore to normality are in a higher amount in the patients that have real hyperinsulinism. So this means that we probably have a good treatment, but metformin is perfect, especially in patients that are with hyperinsulinemia. But the treatment with metformin is not probably the best one, since you know very well that it's an issue if you are 5 kilos above the normal weight. But when the body weight is 25 or 30 kilograms above the body weight, probably the higher levels needed for metformin might induce side effects. But metformin probably is not the best one, but there is a bunch of body weight to lose, and side effects is the most relevant, obviously, dropping doses in these patients. So the real problem in the patients that have hyperinsulinism is not just because they are obese, but probably because there is also the predisposition due to diabetes, which is impairing some kind of signal transduction. And this is absolutely related to the vulnerability due to the presence of a familial diabetes. And remember that in these patients, up to 50-60% of the familiars might have a diabetic, someone in the family. So the other strategy today has been to use and to introduce some natural compounds that are normally present in our biology. And these are the inositols. Inositols is a family which have been at the beginning considered a vitamin, but they are very close to be belonging to the glucose family, since the chemical structure is very close to the one of glucose. And they are relevant, as you can see here from this cartoon, in the signal transduction, not really only for insulin, but also for TSH and FSH. Remember, FSH. So this means in the transduction of the signal inside the cells of the granulosa. So this is rather important. But as you can see, inositols are modulating also the central nervous systems, glucose metabolism, obviously, but mainly also the gene expression. So what are these inositols? Well, inositols are eaten through the food, from beans, from fruits, and you catch exactly myo-inositol. But on the other side, you can produce inositols in your biology, since they can be inositols created through the phosphatization of glucose and through other passages that create, you can see this slide, L-myo-inositol-1-phosphate up to myo-inositol. But the amount of this production, the inner production, the endogenous production, is not so high. So we need to have some of these inositols in our biology. And the relevant fact that we need to know is that these inositols are very close in the chemical structure to the one of glucose. But the relevant fact is that inositols per se are relevant, but they need to be converted to myo-inositols up to dichiro-inositols. Well, the family of the inositols is quite large. There are 9 stereoisomers, perfectly chemically similar, but different in the position of the hydroxyl. Well, the most important in our biology are myo and dichiro. Myo and dichiro need to be present contemporaneously inside the cells, since they have specific and coordinate activities. And as you can see here, myo and dichiro are located in the inner part of the cell membrane. As soon as you have the linkage of insulin on the receptor, on the inner part of the membrane, myo-inositol is, let's say, activated. If it goes on the right hand, it passes through the activation of these specific chains of peptides up to the activation of the PKB-AKT complex, which is able to activate the GLUT4 vesicles that move on the surface of the membranes, and this permits the uptake of glucose from the external part of the cells. But on the other side here, where myo-inositol is activated, myo-inositol can move also on the left and through these other peptides up to this system of the GPI hydroxylase, where the epimerase is contained. Well, we have the conversion of myo to dichiro. Well, this dichiro is quite relevant, important, since, as you can see here, it might be put outside of the cells, and the presence here of dichiro amplifies the insulin linkage on the receptors. But if it's produced and released inside the cells, well, this dichiro, which is named here as INS2, is able to activate the storage of glucose as glycogen. And inside the mitochondria, it activates the oxidative use of glucose, so that you burn glucose to produce energy. So if you think for a while, for one moment, to what is happening here, the two inositols here are relevant, one for the uptake from the external part of the cells of the glucose to put this inside the cytosol. On the other side, dichiro is able to store this as glycogen, so it takes away glucose from the inner part of the cytosol, and on the other side, it reduces again and more the amount of glucose contained in the cytosol, since it burns it inside the mitochondria. So this is important to create a gradient to permit more passage of glucose from the external of the cell inside the cell. So the combination of these two is relevant. And inositol have been started to be used for PCO and mainly for hyperinsulinemia in PCO from the very beginning. More than 12 years ago, we demonstrated that just 2 grams of myo-inositol given to these patients was able to reduce, after 30 minutes of the glucose tolerance test, the amount of insulin released. And this is rather important. This means that you can dominate and modulate the ability to store and to use glucose together with insulin. But again, we here have to focus a little bit on the weak point of such transformation of myo-inositol to dichiro, which is this epimerase. Such epimerization, if it is not properly driven, it creates a lack of dichiro and an excess of myo. Well, Larner, almost 10 years ago, demonstrated checking the amount of myo and dichiro in the urines of patients with diabetes or maybe with PCOS, that if the patient was with PCOS, or maybe the patient with PCOS have someone in the family with diabetes, the dichiro, the myo to dichiro ratio was absolutely higher than the expected, than what observed in normal controls, as you can see here. Well, this means that you do not have the ability to transform myo to dichiro in the proper amount. So we decided several years ago to try to test not just the use of myo, but just the use of dichiro. This is a clinical trial that we made, just treating obese patients, BMI above 30, with a dichiro. And after that, after the treatment of 3 months, we decided to check who among these patients were with the familial diabetes and who were not with the familial diabetes. And you can see here that the patients with familial diabetes have higher response of insulin before the treatment in comparison to those who have no familial diabetes. But on the other side, after the treatment, the response, the curve of response of insulin in the two groups were absolutely similar. No more than 60 here no more than 50-60 here. So this means that the Dikiro was really pairing the system and creating conditions just to understand better the fact that the metabolic machine was working properly. But now it's time to add something else. Since we cannot think that Mother Nature might create a metabolic machine just having one item controlling glucose metabolism. And here comes the second issue of the talk, alpha-lipoic acid. Alpha-lipoic acid is a very unique molecule. It's created and generated inside the mitochondria through a lipase, a lipoic acid synthase, which is able to create lipoic acid. And lipoic acid has a proper activity, which is able to stimulate directly the APKB-AKT protein, which is the one on which MIO is acting, so that to have an amplification of the GLUT4 expression and the positioning of the vesicles on the cell membrane. But on the other side, the very important thing is that lipoic acid is absolutely independent from inositol. So it is working perfectly alone. But there is a real problem after having understood this. And the fact is that whoever have not only the animal models, but also the human being, the presence of diabetes in the family or is diabetic himself, have a reduction of this LASI expression, the lipoic synthase enzyme. And this means that you have the lower production of lipoic acid. So these patients who have diabetes in the family are lacking also a normal production of lipoic acid. And this is something which is really relevant. Relevant up to the moment that we decided recently to test the use of separate amount of MIO inositol or alpha lipoic acid or the combination of two. Since the issue is to understand if those who have a familial diabetes were able to overcome the problem using just MIO or using just lipoic acid or maybe a combination of two. So in the first column of graph, you see here all the patients treated this group with just MIO, and you see here that the maximal response to the oral glucose test of insulin was reduced by MIO inositol, but only in patients who had no, absolutely no diabetic relatives. No changes in patients that have declared to have someone with diabetes. But when we administered this lipoic acid for 100 milligrams every day in another group of obese patients, we had that it was not relevant or not important to have someone with diabetes in the family, since the two groups of patients were responding. And this was happening also when we were having the combination of MIO plus lipoic acid. So what is the issue coming out from this clinical experiment is that the relevant weak point is if you have someone with diabetes in the family, you are lacking the ability of MIO to be effective in the control of glucose metabolism. And if you administer the lipoic acid, you substitute for sure the amount of lipoic acid that your biology inside of the cell is not able to produce. And the combination of the two is no more giving higher performances, but for sure is taking together the control of glucose metabolism. So the following issue was, okay, lipoic acid is relevant, MIO inositol is relevant, but we have for both to understand what kind of patients we have in front of us. So the anamnestic procedure to understand if the patients have someone in the family with diabetes is rather important. So we again decided to perform another study with a combination of Dikiro plus lipoic acid. And you see here the two columns of graphs, here the patients with diabetes in the family, and on the other side, those who had no diabetes in the family. Look at the area under the curve for glucose and for insulin. You see here that we have a reduction, a significant reduction of the area of glucose and also the area of insulin in the patients who had familial presence of diabetes. No changes were observed in the patients with no diabetic relatives, and a slight reduction, which is important to have also these in these patients, when you have no diabetes in the family. So this means that in normal people with no diabetes in the family, probably we are helping even more the ability of the metabolic machine to crunch and to eliminate the excess of glucose, thus reducing the normal response of insulin to the glucose load. So what is the story? The story, we are close to the end, is to understand that PCOS is a rather very common disease, is someone which is triggered by some epigenetic predisposition, but also to the excess of food and to the amount of weight. So obesity is at the base of this. The problem is that the maintenance of the amount of adipose tissue is the one that triggers even more and maintains the insulin resistance. So we need to lose weight to keep food under control, since this for sure maintains a sort of oxidative stress and a pro-inflammation state, which is rather important. We have seen this with Professor Milewicz, that with this, we have a predisposition to cardiovascular disease. So what are the take-home message today? Well, absolutely that we have to check for hyperinsulinemia in these PCOS patients. And what is relevant to check and to understand what is the amnestic story for these patients. We need to know if, as Ibanez have demonstrated, if there is a lady in front of us that was born as a small for gestational age or maybe was a UGR. But mainly, we need to know if there is any diabetic people in the family. Mio is useful, is rather important, but mainly if there is no presence of diabetes in the family. Probably Dikiro is the best one in the presence of obviously diabetes in the family, since the weak point is just the epimerase that transforms Mio to Dikiro. And for sure in these patients also lipoic acid is relevant, important, since also this one is lacking in the presence of diabetes in the family. So what are the choices? Take care of food. Make movement. Agonistic purposes, probably not, but it's better to move, to jog, to work. The combination Mio or Mio plus ALA, just for everyone. But if you need to have the facing of the presence of a vulnerability due to diabetes in the family, probably you need the combination Dikiro plus lipoic acid. Thank you very much to everyone. Thank you.
The question and answer area. And then I would like to start now putting, coming and reading the question who already arrived. And we have from an anonymous attendee, Professor Milewicz, a question: if there a way in which we can get rid, at least lower the levels of endocrine disruptor as such mentioned? And then I would like to add to that question, how you cut down endocrine disruptor in your home? Professor Milewicz, you have to activate your microphone. Yes, okay.
Okay. So according to endocrine disruptors, so I can recommend to avoid endocrine disruptors, to eat more plants, to use for cooking only iron or stainless steel pan or pot, stay away from all plastic, check the labels of cosmetic beauty products because most of them contain paraben. Filter your water and avoid the fake stuff, like for example, freshness candles. So the European Union recommend how we can reduce how we avoid endocrine disruptors in our diet using this suggestion what I told you before.
Thank you. And now a question from Marcus Sachsenmeier to Alessandro Genazzani. Is the chironositol an option in the treatment of gestational diabetes? And I would like to add also you another point arising from Maria Carolina Madi. Patients with polycystic ovary and normal weight can benefit from inositol anti-lipoic acid, alpha lipoic acid?
Well, these are very clever questions. The first issue is that up to now, there are not so many clinical data trials that have demonstrated the efficacy of the chiro during pregnancy. The real problem is that, you know, gestation is something very important, and we are a little bit concerned in using integrative specifically in this period. But I can tell you that whenever you are obese, overweight, and you want to be pregnant, the better is to pre-treat these patients with the most appropriate inositol and to use probably the most natural form of inositol during pregnancy. I mean that you have to take under control body weight, you have to reduce it if possible, to integrate maybe with dichiro plus lipoic acid, especially if you have diabetes in the family. You have to keep food under control, and during pregnancy you might add a little bit of lipoic acid and probably myoinositol. These are the issues that have been demonstrated up to now, since the only clinical trials have been done using myoinositol or myoinositol and lipoic acid.
Thank you. These are the ones. And then another question now to Professor Milevich, which originates from Vineta, and I would like to combine that one. She asks, do we have to perform OGTT for PCO patient? And then my question rises from that, how you can diagnose insulin resistance?
So the insulin resistance, so in my everyday practice, I use oral glucose tolerance test and estimated insulin if 2 hours after 75 gram drinking, after drinking 2 hours, it's over 35 the international unit per liter, so it's insulin resistance. According to advanced glucate end products, it's a very important things, because we can really reduce the number of this bad product which disturb our health, use a limit, making limit of Western diet, prefer food like grains, like legumes, bread, pasta, vegetables, fruits, and change cooking method. I'm most heating, using shorter cooking time, opting for lower temperature, and what we can I can recommend for cooking, tweaking, boiling, or steaming. This method can be recommended, but not grill. And you must remember also that what we're using in Mediterranean diet, vinaigrette and lemon juice reduce the number of advanced glucated end products. That's a very important good news before lunch.
Thank you. And I have another now a question for Alessandro Genazzani, which is originated from Deepan Thakkar. Okay, the question is, according to your experience, what is better, metformin or inositol, with addition of alpha lipoic acid to metformin? This can help. I would like to be aware, according to your experience, what flow chart should the clinician follow to face the better choice of the treatment of insulin resistant in polycystic ovary?
Well, the real problem is the body weight of the patient. If you have just someone with 5 kilos or maybe 8 kilos above the normal weight, the supposed normal weight for the patient, well, probably we can suggest diet plus integration Dikiro, Mio, or Ala together. But if you have consistent obesity with a lot of body weight, you need to play a game which is hard. Not only diet and lifestyle, obviously, but you need probably to urge a best performance of the metabolic machine, adding and combining metformin plus the integrations. The real trick of this is to understand that the metformin is not really working by herself, is acting at least 30-50% of its action through the inositol pathways. It works on the expression, metformin induces the expression of epimerase. So it's quite clear that if you have a familial diabetes and you use metformin, probably these are the patients that needs to have a very high amount of metformin. And the combination of metformin plus Dikiro in these patients, it's more helpful than just metformin alone. But everything starts from a correct lifestyle. Remember, dieting and having in the brain the will of losing weight is the best treatment that you might have.
And then now for Professor Milevics, what do you recommend women according to the vitamin D deficiency? Because this is another chapter of very high importance.
Yes, it's very important. So I must say it depends of time of the life of women. But for pregnant women, so I recommend absolutely supplementation, even if the vitamin D levels is normal. So we recommend 2000 units for every day during whole pregnancy till the delivery. Mostly I prescribe this vitamin D, vigantolatin tablets, plus magnesium, 400 milligram magnesium. And according to menopause is also very important because of bone. And so our study of Paul Senior study shows that most of aging people in Poland so presented really big vitamin D deficiency. For that reason, so 2000 is also usually is a very, very helpful dose every day during the breakfast, for example, time, and with also I recommend with magnesium. And also as I show you in many times ago, also the woman with PCOS, the vitamin D supplementation is very important. Also help the problem with insulin resistance. You're also one of this chain. Thank you.
Then I have a question for Alessandro also on an area which I like very much. It is the insulin resistance a relevant issue at menopausal transition for PCO patients? As you know, at transition of the menopause, sometimes we have a further weight gain, which is dependent from just for the transition.
Yeah, this is an incredible topic that needs to be pushed a little bit to the attention of the clinicians. Menopause per se is a moment of the women's life where a physiological insulin resistance will occur. So if this is a PCO patient who have a past medical history with PCOS, for sure she will have a insulin resistance that will drive her up to the menopausal transition where such insulin resistance will be improved. So we know very well that the metabolic syndrome has his millstone in insulin resistance and in all this metabolic situation of the lipid profiles. And such kind of issues are related to insulin resistance. So whenever we have a patient during the menopausal transition that tell us that someone is changing the body weight, we have always to check immediately for insulin resistance, to know what was going on when she was in fertile life, normal adult, normal adolescence, to check if there was an overweight or insulin resistance or PCOS, true PCOS during fertile life. Since these are not two completely different items, these are perfectly combined. Patients that have insulin resistance and PCOS during fertile life are perfect candidates to have insulin resistance and a higher cardiovascular disease at the moment of menopause. So it's relevant to explain the patients such kind of risk, to keep young patients under control of their lifestyle and, if possible, treatment during adult fertile life to avoid the occurrence of a worst physiological incredible breakout during menopause. So we need to keep this in mind with menopausal transition.
And then now just two very short last questions. One is for Professor Milevich. How to avoid unhealthy advanced glucation and products in your life?
So I told you before that limit the Western diet, prefer food as mostly pasta, vegetables, fruits, and change the cooking method. We don't use as a grill, mostly steaming, boiling, or staving. So that's a way that you can reduce as advanced glycated end product. And also is a good news is that metformin treatment reduce also the amount of advanced glycated product. Thank you.
And from an anonymous attendee, Alessandro, that can be the maximal duration of use of the dihydroinositol plus alpha lipoic acid. Alessandro, you are still there?
Or is something, it's stopped.
Is something wrong? Okay, I think we will try to send to our attendee through the chat channel the response.
Thank you so much.
All of you. I think Alessandro, okay, the question was, is for how long we can use dihydroinositol and alpha lipoic acid?
Well, being those integrative approach, we can use them for very long times. These are natural products that are normally produced in our biology.
And do you use for a fasting condition or after the meal?
Well, usually I suggest to have them in between breakfast and lunch, from the eating of something that can produce after digestion glucose, since inositols are structurally similar to glucose, so they compete for the absorption inside the cells with glucose. So far away from breakfast or lunch.
Thank you.
And then I have to add something, because with this approach, inositol and alpha lipoic acid, some diet and some moving and then some exercise, I have lost 2 years ago 9 kilos, and they have not been come back again. And then think I have directly proved.
Okay, that's important.
Then we would like to thank all of you and to thank all the participants to that webinar. And it's my pleasure to announce that for the next webinar in 2 weeks from now, we will have a fantastic topic, not common, which is transsexualism. You can see here, adolescent transgender and endocrinology of transsexuality. And we have two masters, Charles Sultan from Montpellier, professor of pediatrics, and Svetlana Vujovic from Belgrade, professor of endocrinology. The first will speak about adolescent transgender, and the second, she will speak about endocrinology of transsexuality. Dear friend, I wait you in 2 weeks from now here, and thank to Professor Milevich for his talk on insulin resistance and to Alessandro Genassani on the integrative therapies. It was a very good webinar.
Thank you.
From
see you soon.
Be safe.
Yes, we have the mask. I have left the mask.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, bye-bye. Bye-bye.